Leia here from leiaforsci.com, and in this video, we're going to look at the reaction energy diagram for an SN1 reaction. First, a quick reminder of the SN1 reaction as I teach in the substitution elimination video series linked below. SN stands for nucleophilic substitution, and the 1 stands for unimolecular. Be careful, unimolecular does not mean one step. Uni means one, molecular is molecule, telling us that this reaction has one molecule reacting at a time, which means this is going to be a multi-step reaction, with a key identifying intermediate as the carbocation. SN1 and E1 reactions have a carbocation, SN2 and E2 do not have intermediates, therefore they will never have a carbocation. The rate of an SN1 reaction is equal to some constant K times the concentration of the substrate. Notice that it's only the substrate we're taking into account, not the nucleophile, as we do with an SN2 reaction. And this is going to be very important when we're understanding why we have a higher activation energy in the first step of the SN1 reaction. For this energy diagram, we're going to look at the simple reaction when 2-iodo-2-methylpropane reacts with sodium chloride to give us 2-chloro-2-methylpropane with NaI on the side. A quick review of the mechanism that I teach in the SN1 videos linked below. The first step is the leaving group breaking away from the carbon chain on its own. Nothing kicks it out. It simply grabs those electrons and breaks away to give us an iodine floating around in solution that we don't care about and a carbocation intermediate. Because nothing kicks out that iodine, this is the rate determining step. That carbocation formation is the slow and rate determining step. And then Cl minus, not NaCl, because Na is a positive spectator, but Cl minus takes advantage of that positive carbon, attacks to form a new bond to give us our final product with a chlorine attached where the iodine used to be. You'll also see reactions where something like water or alcohol attacks. That will require yet another step for deprotonation, but for now we're going to look at a simple two-step reaction. Given that the Cl takes advantage of a carbocation that formed, this is the fast step. And because it's the fast step, we don't see it in the rate law for this reaction. When looking at a reaction energy diagram, we're trying to understand what happens to the energy of the system. What happens to the energy of the molecules when we go from the reactant, in our case the 2-iodo-2-methylpropane, to have the iodine break away, to form a carbocation intermediate, and ultimately get the final product? Since this is an energy diagram, the y-axis is going to measure energy, where something that is low energy is relatively stable, and something high energy is relatively unstable. I like to think of the x-axis, or the reaction coordinate, as time. As the reaction proceeds, as time passes by, what happens to the energy of the system? In the first step of this reaction, we have a molecule that is stable enough. It exists, it can be isolated. But we give it a boost of energy. We start putting energy into the system so that the iodine can slowly, slowly break away. And the more energy we put in the system, the more that iodine breaks away until we get to the maximum energy of this molecule, which is called the transition state, or this funky symbol. And that transition state is not the intermediate, it's not the carbocation. Instead, we have a carbon with 3 methyl groups and an iodine that is slowly breaking away. That transition state shows us what the molecule looks like when the iodine isn't completely attached, but also not completely broken off. The starting molecule is neutral. We know that when the iodine breaks away, iodine will be negative and the carbocation, cation, will be positive. As the bond is breaking, iodine becomes more and more partially negative until it gets a full negative when it breaks away, and carbon becomes more and more partially positive to have a full positive when the iodine breaks away. The energy required to get to this point, meaning the difference in energy from our starting molecule to the top of the hump, that transition state, is called the EA, or energy of activation. And this is the energy that has to be put into the system, almost like that kick to get it going. But once it reaches the top of that peak, once we're at the transition state, the iodine continues to fully break away and give us a somewhat stable, a molecule that we can isolate called the intermediate. We talk about carbocation intermediates, and we know that tertiary is more stable than secondary, which is more stable than primary, but they're still unstable molecules. They're stable enough where we have a valley, meaning it comes down enough to be able to rest for a minute before it gets up to continue reacting, but ultimately it's not that stable. And because it's not that stable, it's looking to react quickly. The next step, where the chlorine comes to attack, is not an instantaneous reaction, meaning we need a little bit of energy to get this thing going, but because the system is already at such a high energy, it's not a big deal to get to this lower energy state by comparison. We hit another hump, meaning a second transition state, and this is where the tert-butyl carbocation has a partially formed bond to the incoming chlorine. Chlorine started out with a negative charge, but as it forms a bond to carbon, that negative charge will disappear and it'll be neutral. So the transition state shows chlorine with a partial negative as it's slowly losing that charge. The carbocation is going to be neutral when it's attached to chlorine. So the transition state shows a partial positive charge as the carbocation is slowly, slowly losing that charge, forming that bond. And as that bond forms stronger and stronger, the energy is released, the system becomes more and more stable, until we get a final product that is so stable by comparison that the energy is so, so low. We know that the second step is a relatively fast step, but it still requires an activation energy, so we would show yet another activation energy. But look at the difference. Look how big the initial activation energy is compared to that second activation energy. And anytime you're trying to identify your rate-determining step, the slow step in the reaction, ask yourself which one has a higher activation energy. And because it's so high, because we need so much energy to get to that point, that is how we know it's the slower step. This is so low, it's so quick, it's so easy, it's a fast step. And finally, when you compare the energy of the starting molecule to the final product, you'll notice that the final product is lower in energy. That means energy was released to complete the reaction, giving us a negative delta G for a spontaneous reaction. Let's quickly review the structures that we have here. The starting molecule, relatively okay in energy. We give it a boost of energy, a whole lot of energy, because this is the slow rate determining step for a transition state where the iodine is breaking away, getting partial charges. We have a carbocation intermediate, which we can isolate, unlike the transition state. It's not very stable, but it can rest for a second. The chloride will come in and attack, giving us another transition state that we cannot isolate. With a lower energy of activation, because it's an easier and faster step. And when the bonds are fully formed, the energy is released, the final molecule is very stable. For even more on SN1 reactions, first, give this video a thumbs up. Make sure you subscribe to my channel so you never miss another video. Then go to my website, see the link below, or go to layerforsci.com/substitutionelimination.